to introduce someone. I'll be remiss if I forget to do that. Someone from CPLA and is Dr. Mr. Robbie Bolton, our head librarian, and he's going to say a few words on behalf of the committee.
Thank you, Dr. Chan, and I'll just stand here since I don't have a mic to use. But this is our very first event of Focus Series 2017. I'm happy to be here representing the CPLA committee. One of the functions of our faculty committee is to put together Focus Series every year. Our theme this year is risk and failure. And so I was very excited when Dr. Chan and Dr. Lewis said, can we do something on getting married to financial planning and starting out your post-college life. So excited that this is our first workshop. There are some brochures on the table in the back. I think many of you gobbled them up already in their schedules. We have 19 faculty workshops this year that are happening, and that's in addition to our three keynote talks. We have Peter Enns, a theologian, coming to speak tomorrow night and Wednesday during Focus Day. And we have Catherine Hayhoe, an evangelical climate scientist, who is going to be talking about the failure and risks of managing our climate. So I hope you'll attend not just this one, but some of our other Focus events throughout the week. And for those of you that do not have a chair, I've got people coming to bring us a few more chairs. So this will be a problem
to have. Many seats up here, there are about 7 or 8 empty chairs, so that don't leave the chairs by themselves. Come on up and fill them up. I'd love to have you sit closer to the front. In fact, you can hear better. You can also ask questions more readily. Let's be honest, how many of you are here because someone told you have to go to one of the sessions? Be honest, okay? How about half and half? So the other half, you cannot wait, right? The other half, you can't wait to hear what the panelists have to say. So, we're not going to keep you from hearing the sound advice from this panel. I'm moderating, but I'm also having some information to get started with. If the technology works, if it doesn't, we'll skip that part. I might just read from my notes, and then we'll get to the heart of our session tonight. I also want to make mention of a group that's here tonight, is the Enactus student group. Some of you have heard of Enactus that went on to National last year, and they're also here helping with hosting events. And there's snacks and bottled water at the tables. We also have one of our panelists bringing some literature from her organization at that table back there. So when you're done, by all means, welcome back and pick up something, whether it is something to eat or to think, food for thought. And we also have a survey. We only printed 100 copies to see how not pessimistic. I wasn't very confident in the audience, how many people would come. In fact, when Anna sits at the table, and I talk, she's about, how about 50? I said, no, I didn't have more people than 50, but how many more? I think we have probably 160, 170 people here tonight, which is great. We don't want to spend time on things that are not value-adding, so we'll go quickly to the session. The session is titled, "For the Ring by Spring." I'm not going to ask you to show hands of your rings, but the question is, well, tied to the text of the really? Or really? Exclamation mark and question mark. There's some myths in the notion. And if we have time, we could go into maybe video clip showing you some movies and whatnot. People are talking about, oh, if you're graduating, you must. Oh, thank you. Hello? Can you hear me? Can you hear me now? Okay. Well, this is what Aaron said, he's the director of media support. Let's thank him one more time. This way you don't have to shout. You don't ever want to hear him shout. Anyway. Wow, that's great. So, when we put together this for the workshop, or this panel discussion, for the idea is what the we want to clear some of the misconceptions about the, if you are graduating as a guy, you need to be prepared to give a ring to someone, or if you're a girl, be prepared to accept a ring. Otherwise, what the, you're no good. You can't graduate. You can't graduate. Now let it crack. Actually, the slides are not moving, so we'll stay with this slide. Let me introduce our panelists. What the, starting on my far right, what the, everyone knows what Dr. Lewis is the finance guru. And then sitting next to me is what the Brandon Ansel, class of 1998. And he is a business owner of seven businesses.
Class of 2001.
Oh, it's the other guy. Okay. Oh. 1998.
I'm that old yet.
You're a little older than you. You
are. I am old though.
Okay. Well, Brandon is one of our own graduates, and he started several businesses, and he's an entrepreneur, and we're going to we'll be asking some questions too, particularly the pertaining to his what the business experiences and how risk taking he is. And off to the left, we have two ladies. Well, to my immediate left is what the Shelby Rains, executive director of the organization, which is called the Marriage Matters Jackson. She's a graduate of 1996. Well, she's one of my first students and a business major as well. And sitting next to her, we have a current student and also the Enactus for the president. The name is what the Hannah Snyder. Everybody say hi to Hannah.
Hi.
She's the youngest but the member of the panel, and we need to cheer her up. Well, I asked her to be part of this panel to provide this response to our panelists. And then I will open up the floor for Q&A to every one of you, and we'll have microphones that are going to be passed around for you to ask questions. Ask pointed questions. Don't go easy on any one of these for the experts. Promise? Thumbs up? Yes, yes, yes. Well, I have some quick slides that I want to show you, and many of you have heard of that, of the, what's the top reason? I mean, top 10 reasons what the people, the fail the marriages, while finances is one. Is it well, that they don't have money? It's not necessarily the case. Sometimes what is, well, they don't communicate enough about how they should be managing their resources. So that's one possibility. And another slide, well, finance arguments early on in relationship may predict divorce. No couples when they're dating would argue on finances, agree? But the sooner, well, as soon as what they get married, well, financial arguments will come up for some reason. And why is it so? And can we the help our young people avoid that? So we have experts in our midst. It's from Huffington Post. Okay, this slide actually is what the very interesting a study done by the Duo did analysis based on national survey of our families and households. They are correlating, say the is the like a frequency of arguments. Well, less than once per month all the way to the almost every day, and self-reporting on how likely is going to increase the chance of divorce. Those who have taken statistics, you know, there's a linear function. There's an upward trend, positive correlation, so to speak. So the more arguments, the more likely, say, divorce would be coming. did money cost us to what? The Bible says what the death would cost us to what? But many times, money, arguments, will do the same thing. The quote says, what well, approximately 50% of marriages result in, say, divorce, and the 80% cited the financial problems as the major cause of divorce. It's not like they don't have the chemistry within a couple of years of marriage, but it's because of finance issues, financial planning, or lack of, based on CAR 2003. Well, in more the sophisticated study, if you will, as academics, what we like to see, oh, this is a paper that's written in a journal, and this is one of those. The title is for the financial harmony, a key component of successful marriage relationship. So by a couple of researchers at NCSU, North Carolina State University. And one quote from the study, actually, is the conclusion. With marriage being such an important part of society and money seeming to be the major conflict, how very important it is that marriage and money issues be addressed before marriage and during relationship workshops, seminars, and conferences. The difficulty lies in marketing educational opportunities to encourage attendance. Sometimes we try to shy away from the most important topic. Because while people, frankly, don't want to hear that, oh, we're getting ready to get married. I'm going to get a ring or give a ring. Well, don't cause me to change my mind. I'm going to go that direction. But the education is important, and it really tickles us to see that many of you chose to come. We know that some of you have no choice, but many of you have choice. You can still choose to go to another workshop that would allow you to write your assignment. Hopefully, you would not go home disappointed. Couple more. I don't read this to you, but the signs that someone is a bad money manager, and you may ask yourself, does it describe me? You're almost always worried about money. God doesn't want us to worry about anything, not even money. You have credit card debt even though you make a decent salary. Well, you don't have a salary, students. But maybe you know someone who does have a good salary, but still that use the credit cards too often. You have a tendency for buying expensive things. Or maybe a pair of jeans without brand is $15, but the brand name jeans, pair of jeans, what they cost you $150, I go with the $150. Even though I know I can buy 10 pairs if there's no brand. You can read the rest. Okay. The question is what our Christians example from the curses that many non-Christians are cursed with by the devil. I am a strong believer that the devil knows very well how to break up our Christian society, and by first of all, breaking up marriages. Is one of the institutions that God ordained, but if the enemy gets a foothold of Christian marriages, well, God's kingdom can be belittled by that. So with that, I'm going to turn it to my colleagues, everybody here on the panel, they're my colleagues, and I have some questions for them. We'll start with general questions. Which means that any one of them can chime in if they don't have, I doubt it if they don't have much to say, but if they say, Randy has already said enough on this topic, I'm going to just pass and just fine. And then we also have customized questions for individuals. And this way we get to hear from, say, different people on the perspective, especially what they say, from Marriage Matters Jackson.
What about, I mean, the perspective as a business person, a finance professor, or might be that as a student, is getting ready to graduate. So, my first question, and I don't have it on the slide, so I'm gonna sit down. Is, when you see the phrase, spring by spring, what comes to mind? What's your personal view on the wisdom or the lack of in doing so? What are the dangers of taking this too lightly? So, the microphones are on, so I pass one down that way.
I feel like this was teed up for me. Can I stand up? Because I can't see everybody. This is exactly what I do all the time, so I appreciate you inviting me to come because I have a lot to say on this. Let's have a whole other seminar if you guys like this. We'll talk about it another time. But Ring by Spring, what I learned, I was a Spring Arbor graduate, so I know what Ring by Spring is. I understand the phenomenon. We live in a cold place. You're sitting in the lounges. You're talking about just your hopes and dreams and your deep, dark secrets and all this stuff. And, you know, in high school, it would have taken you 6 months to know somebody as well as you know somebody in 2 weeks here. I get it. I totally get it. What happens is spring comes and the weather breaks up and people are starting to get outside more. And then you start talking more with this person that you just found was your soulmate in the lounge during the winter, okay? So what happens is then the thaw comes and then, you know, you go home for the summer, you get together, they meet your family, you meet their family, and you're like, oh my goodness, I don't like this person as much as I thought. Because what you had was an incubator relationship. There's actually a word for it, incubator relationship. Anything that is intense, done in a kind of quick amount of time, military relationships can be like this, college relationships, because you're in an environment where you can hang out all the time. You know the relationships where they sit until the lounge is closed and they have to go to their room, and then they meet for breakfast, and then their eyes together, and then they stand by the oak tree, and they're you get it. You know who it is, and you're like, gag. Those are incubator relationships, because you can only keep that intensity so long. What I worry about with incubator relationships is that you are not discussing things like finances. That's not the fun, warm fuzzies. You're talking about what your life was like at, growing up and all these fun things and what are your hopes and dreams, and you skip over this big chunk in the middle. So yes, I believe that there is a fun part to Ring by Spring, but I can't tell you how many people now flash forwarding that I know that I'm going, oh yeah, they were a Ring by Spring couple, and by summer they were not so much doing great. So I want you guys to learn the difference between things that make you stick together in a good way, long-term relationships, and things that get you stuck. And there's a lot of big differences between those.
Great. Thank you, Shelby. Anyone else?
Hi, I've been married for 18 years, been with my wife for about 21 years. And I can tell you the number one thing you guys need to know when you get married is that you dictate the type of marriage you have. Your spouse does not dictate the type of marriage you have. And so whether it be finances or spiritual things about your life or whatever you want to talk about, okay, that person is going to be completely different from you and living in a completely different bubble of perception, okay, literally a different reality. And so if you know that up front, you're never going to ever have to be angry or have conflicts with your spouse. You literally can just be seeking to understand and investigate what the heck's going on in that other person's mind that is completely different from yours, okay? So I offer that up to you guys saying, I wish I'd have known that the first 10 years of my marriage, because I would get frustrated and I'd say, well, this girl I love and who loves me so much, why doesn't she know what I'm thinking? Oh my God, she literally has no idea what I'm thinking. She's a completely separate, independent human being with her own thoughts and dreams. And so when I literally dropped all expectation on our marriage and just loved her for who she was, I realized that, oh my gosh, any issues that I'd ever thought I had in my marriage, A, weren't real, and B, were because of me. She came to some type of similar conclusion because she had similar issues that were in her mind. We literally were two completely separate humans trying to make one beautiful thing, right? So that's my canned response to marriage. You control the future of your marriage. You control it by being the type of person that you want to be married to yourself, right? That's important. Be the type of person you want to be married to, because we kind of end up mirroring each other. I look at my wife, we've been together 20 years, she can't ask me if I love her. I am her. We have become each other in a lot of ways. four kids in, that's what I got for it.
Guaranteed.
Can you hear me? Yes?
Well, I guess my thought would be that, you know, the question is, what are the dangers of taking this too lightly? Well, you know, you're 20 years old, you've got marriage going on 50 years. Think about that just for a moment. Taking it too lightly, what does that really mean? That means that you've got most of your life ahead of you in marriage, and you're just gonna jump right in. And that just doesn't make much sense. So if you're a female out there and you some guy comes up and you says, you wanna marry me, you say, well, I really wanna talk to my finance professor about this, make sure it's okay.
But, by the way, there's a sign sheet at the back. You want to talk to Douglas tonight, tomorrow?
So I guess my feeling is that, I mean, yeah, that's insane to rush marriage. I mean, that's the most important thing you can do besides accepting Christ, right? So it's like, why would you want to rush something that important? And not, I mean, if you're really sure that that's the right person, and you've had proper counseling and all that, then yeah, but boy, you better be careful, that's all I can say.
So there's really a danger of taking something like that too lightly, or trying to hurry it and tying the knot. We see that the other people are doing that, but I think it's the peer pressure, so to speak. I want to go back to the brain that you said that something along the line of that you have to control. I want to make sure that we don't misinterpret that as well. We control that relationship.
No, you can only control yourself. I literally wake up every day thankful that my wife is there. She's a guest in my home. I'm so honored that she chooses to live her life with me. And so it's the opposite of that, my friend. I have no control in our relationship. Trust me.
Well, I think that reminds me of a wise what the person who say well, in marriages, this is how, what you do, guys. All the big decisions, those are made by men. The small decisions are made by women. What makes a big or small decision is a small decision. Get it? So you defer everything to your wife. You think, well, it's a big decision, well, she will think it's a small decision. So things get settled that way. All right, let's move on. You want to say something too?
Yeah. Okay. I was just gonna say the whole incubator thing kind of sets with me because as college students, we wake up, we live in a dorm, generally speaking, we eat in the DC, and I don't pay bills other than my tuition. So it is kind of interesting point that I don't know how I spend my money. I don't know if I want to spend more money on an apartment or a car or if I want to travel more because I kind of feel like I'm not an adult yet. I know that's not everyone because some people do live on their own, but as a college student, I feel like I don't really know how I'm going to spend my money yet.
Great. Well, thank you, Dakina, and appreciate the sharing all of your perspectives. We talk about finances, and poor finances seem to be the rather common reason for the marriage failures, especially Americans. What would you propose that today's young people do before they tie the knots, knowing that some are more rational than the others, and those others are deeply influenced by the romantic relationship and may not be able to think as clearly? So what would you say? Any further advice?
Yeah, I'm always full of it, but do you guys know how long it takes to actually really know somebody, like actually know them?
25 years.
20, yeah, exactly. But to really get to see somebody's patterns and to know things, it takes about 2 years. To really get to see patterns in their life, to see, because when you guys start out and you like somebody, and we call it the tingles, if any of you came for Adventures in Dating earlier in the semester, we talked about that. The tingles is this thing that chemical reaction that happens and you just see them, and like tonight, if you have the tingles for somebody in this room, when they walked in, it was like they were backlit, and it was like, ah, there it is, you know. And so that can last a couple of years, and then you have to start posting into a real relationship on the real part of who each other are. You stop brushing your hair or your teeth or something like that at that point. You're not putting necessarily your best foot forward all the time. But when you start out, you do. Like, you would make sure that you have everything put together. You're not gonna tell your worst horrible things. You don't go on a date with somebody for the first time and be like, hey, I'm a hot mess. Just wanted to let you know that. That's not how we start out. So it takes 2 years on average to get to know somebody and to see their patterns. If they're a thief, if they're a liar, if they're all these things, love is blind, and when we feel that tingly sensation, we kind of overlook that. And people are like, wait, she's actually a terrible human being. And you're like, oh, she's so pretty. And she hangs out with me until 2 a.m. in the lounge. That's what I'm talking about some of this. We blind ourselves to it. And you're talking about, great point, about 50 years is a long time. So don't make these impulsive decisions at this point. And I want to tell you, here's a secret formula I want to leave with you. There's 3 T's that help you really feel close to somebody. And if one of them is missing, that's going to create a problem in this relationship that you're exploring for a couple of years and starting to see these patterns. You've got to have talk. So you both got to be able to communicate. If one of you is like the strong silent type and you never talk, or you talk in grunts, that doesn't work. Talk. Talk means I give some, you give some. I give some, you give some. You don't have a person that talks in huge paragraphs. It's like you talk back and forth. Talk. Second one is time. You've got to have time together. Now that's where that incubator fools you into thinking, oh, we have been together for 3 weeks. We are serious. No, well, okay. It felt like that. It felt like a lot, but you've got to have time. And so that means that couple of years. You've got to have some time to see how this really works in a lot of different situations. And those different situations are togetherness. So talk, time, and togetherness. Togetherness is sharing experiences outside of the incubator, going places with each other. If you go on a missions trip together, maybe you're cross-cultural, you end up on the same cross-cultural trip, you'll know if you love or hate that person by the end of international travel with someone, okay? These are things that you need to do. You need to visit each other's crazy family. You need to meet that crazy aunt and know that that's part of their genetics. You need to know these things. It's true, you know it is. So those things, talk, time, togetherness. And togetherness might be something that you feel like we're together, but are you together in a variety of different situations? Have you met their family? Have you met their other friends besides the people here? Do you know all these different things? So that's where I want to say, these are important years. And you're trying to make, we get it, you're trying to make decisions about what you want to do with your life, you know, how you're going to serve God, what you're going to do with your life professionally, also personally. We understand you're in deep water, but we want to help you give these little tools like this that you can say, if you're in a relationship right now and things get kind of choppy, figure out, is it talk, time, or togetherness? Are you not seeing each other very much? Are you kind of missing each other? What's happening there? That's a really basic thing to always go back to see if you're missing. And money and finances go right together with those things. If you're avoiding it, or if you're talking about it too much and it's overshadowing everything in your relationship, you need to put it in its proper place.
Anybody else? Mm-hmm. My question is about how do you bring financial matters up in a dating relationship? When you're dating, or you talk about dating stuff, right? But any advice?
Yeah.
That's for us, French.
I think, you know, when you're dating, you know, it's important to talk about money. I did with my wife. Maybe it's because I'm a finance professor. I don't know. But I did. I said, you know, how do you... my wife had some credit card debt. I'll be honest with you. She had some credit card debt when we met. And that sort of bothered me. And I said, well, it's, you know, that kind of put a wall up for a moment. And then I said, well, how do you feel about that? I said, you know, do you want to pay it off? And she said, yes. And I said, well, and then once we got talking about marriage, I said, you know, we really need to talk about this before we commit to marriage. And really what the discussion we had was that we would pay that off before we got married. So I said, you know, she said, I'm weak in that area, I need some help. And I said, well, I will help you with that. We need to pay the debt off before we get married, and I will help you with that in any way I can. And we sat down and decided how I was gonna help her with that, because she asked. And I think those discussions are really critical to have, especially about debt and about savings, those two areas.
Can I piggyback on what you said? I love how you handled that, because I think a lot of times when we're not good at something, we've been told we can be good at everything. I love that she had the humility to say, I'm not great at this, can you help me? That's a partnership. And I love that you came around and didn't say, well, yes, I'm a financial guru. And you didn't lord it over her. And so she felt safe to do that. I think that was, I love that example, because you can break that apart and say, if you are weak in that area, you have to be able to admit it. And if you are strong in that area, you need to have the humility to be able to say, let me carry this with you and not make you feel shameful about that. I think that's a very huge point, because I think that a lot of times the opposite happens, that we hide our weaknesses and we lord over our strengths. We need to balance those out.
And the nice thing about this is what that God made us in a way that we are not all perfect, and that we complement one another as couples. So that, well, Randy did not tell you his weaknesses. I'm not going to tell you either. But I have weaknesses that my wife can compliment me or help me overcome. And likewise, what that she has weaknesses that I also did try to help her. So we would be a couple, and this couple would need one another the rest of our life. Not for 1 year, 2 years, 5 years, 10 years. Okay, we're going to shift gear to the customized questions. I'm going to start with Brandon, and because what the theme is about risk and failure. And as an entrepreneur, a young entrepreneur, you've started many businesses. I think 7, to be precise, since your early 20s. What are your thoughts on risk and failure? Does the notion of risk ever prevent, stop you from, making some financial decisions, especially in terms of investing in an area that might be, you look at that as very profitable, but might be it doesn't turn out that way?
From a marriage perspective, my wife and I got married so young, and we communicated pretty well about financial stuff because I was interested in finance and she simply was not. And so our kind of contract, our agreement was that I would handle that stuff and that I would just be honest with her about it. And so it was very easy from a marital standpoint to take a lot of risk. And that's what I've done in my career. I woke up one day as a young person about your age and realized I was just never gonna wanna work for somebody else. I had done it at a rubber stamping plant, and it just seemed like hell. There was no better word for it. And so I found my life's call in starting businesses and operating businesses and helping other people be successful. And in my mind, failure in business was not possible, because as you've heard, there's no mistakes in life, there's lessons. I think Big Sean said that. I hope you don't know who he is. But literally, the only risk is not doing what God made you to do. Like, you all know what's up. You guys all know what's up, right? You're independent human beings. You have the creator of the universe inside you, and you know what makes your heart sing. So if you're doing anything that isn't that, I would highly suggest you stop and go do something different. And I would highly suggest you do it for yourself. There's just no higher call in life than creating value for yourself and your family and for other people, in my opinion. So I hope that you'll consider business and entrepreneurship and creativity. I know that there's artists and business people inside of every single human. You know, you can't get away from business in life. And it's been the greatest blessing to my marriage to be able to control my own finances, to control my own business, because it gave me the flexibility to spend more time with my wife and to talk to her more and to be together more. And there was times that there was sacrifices as well, but we always communicated, and that is the key, you guys, in life, in business, in marriage. Just communicate. Communicate really, really well with each other. Don't assume things, okay? Especially not in marriage. Life is so much better. You're a better business person. You're a better friend. You're a better spouse, boyfriend, girlfriend. If you just communicate well with each other and speak your truth, that's what I got.
Well, Brandon, you also said.
I don't remember the question.
don't know. Sorry. Brandon, you also reminded me of a book that you wrote, The Next Right Thing to Do. 1 year, you had an injury, you couldn't go to work, you work from home, from hospital, you wrote the book, The Next Right Thing to Do. So can you give us the glimpse of what that book is all about? And I thought you were also good to work on another book.
I love to write, and I would highly suggest every one of you write down your thoughts and your dreams. You literally create the future with your thoughts and words. As Dr. Chan said, I broke my hip in 2013 and had some free time and wrote all my thoughts down, and it came together in a book that I called The Next Right Thing. And it was just a simple thought concept that had guided my entire life as I was constantly focused, whether in my marriage, in my businesses, in family matters, what's the next right thing I should be doing? I've recently launched a company called Pitch.me, a tech company. If you go to www.pitch.me, you can see what I'm doing. But what it is, it's the marketplace for human attention. Because the most valuable thing that every one of you humans has is your attention. Because without your attention, nothing can happen in life. When you put your attention to something, though, that's when you change the world. That's when you can literally do whatever it is you set your mind to. And so for me, the next right thing was just focusing on what do I give my attention to? Because that's what being a human is. You're given this gift of existence, and what you decide to do with it, that's the results that you get in your life, right? Does anyone not believe that? Okay, good, because that's true. Thank you for mentioning that, though. It's on Amazon, check it out.
I got a commission, 5%.
You haven't broken anything to be able to write another book.
No, I need more freedom. I've actually written 6 more, I just haven't published one.
Oh, they're ready to go.
I got stuff to say.
Okay, well, we'll move on and we'll come back to the Brandon later on. And let me shift gears and ask about Randy a couple questions. But I know that Randy, because well, I've known him for more than 20 some years, he also does what the marital counseling. Primarily is on financial counseling. And my question is about can you share in 60 seconds a version of your premarital financial counseling with us?
No. I'll try.
All right.
First of all, I want to tell you that most of the counseling revolves around finances, as you can probably guess. But the majority of it revolves around finances. But I think that main thing is to get counsel before you get married. Getting counsel is the biggest thing. And then once you do get counseled, then you know what I try to do is focus on debt, how much debt they have, how they're going to get rid of it, their individual ideas about debt and how to manage debt, and then about savings, about how much to save and when to save and where to save and all those kinds of issues. And if the couple says we haven't talked about finances yet, I get, you know, the red flags go up immediately. Timeline for, you know, all this stuff, make a timeline for paying off debt and saving. Who's gonna save, who's gonna manage the money, who's gonna manage the checkbook, who's gonna, you know, if one person's stronger in that area, you have to decide that for sure. Do a budget, talk to them about a budget and how to follow it. I try to get them to use my budget because I developed my own budget when my own marriage started to get a little shaky because of finances. I decided I would develop my own budget and use it. And after I used that budget, things went very well. So I think that's another thing that I try to focus on is budgeting.
I think he did pretty good. Good 60 seconds given, and he covers the most important parts of premarital counseling from a financial standpoint. Follow-up question would be how well are the biblical principles embedded in the marital counseling?
Well, there's more said about in the Bible, more said about money than any other subject. So I guess I stand on good footing there. But I guess that there's a bunch of verses that I kind of focus on, but I'll just read this one to you because I think it's pretty cool. And it comes out of Luke 16:11, and it says, "And if you are untrustworthy about worldly wealth,
who will trust you with the true riches of heaven? Doesn't that say a lot right there? I mean, if you can't be trusted with money here, then how can you be trusted in heaven? So I think the counseling, financial counseling and biblical truths go hand in hand. You can't have one without the other. You need to talk about financial responsibility, debt, giving, greed, and how God provides in your life, how God will provide for you in your life as far as financial things are considered. So the Bible just covers just an enormous amount of ground in that particular area.
Thank you, Randy. Let me go to the Joey, and we'll come back to Hannah later on. Joey is the executive director of Marriage Matters Jackson, which is an organization, nonprofit that you started. You founded the organization, and you have been executive director since the inception of it.
10 years ago.
What do you see as the organization's top priorities in terms of helping young people? And to experience the full joy of a marriage relationship, whether they are thinking about getting married or they are already married. In fact, well, I know that some of the people who frequent your seminars, workshops, they are people who have been married for quite some time.
That's right.
So tell us about it.
Well, we have three P's. This is our vision, is to promote the value of healthy marriage, so people know that marriage is a good thing. Because I think in our culture, we've diminished that to marriage just being like, well, if you feel like it, or if it suits you, or only. There are actually vows that say, I will love you as long as our love lasts. I don't know about you guys, but love's there, but I don't always like my husband. He doesn't always like me. So those are dangerous things. So we promote the value of healthy marriage and what that looks like. We also help people prepare for marriage. That's what we're doing, talking to you guys. That is a great area that is a passion for me in particular. I teach four great dates before you say I do, to seriously dating and engage people. I want to get you before you're even engaged to talk about these things, because a lot of times I'm saying stick versus stuck. Stick together are things that are the glue. Stuck is you get kind of in this relationship and you just stay there. I want to help people prepare for marriage, knowing what some of these big things coming up might be and how to prepare for them, how to head off some of these things. And then the third thing is preserve. And that's what you're talking about with people that have been married 40, 50 years. There's never a time that somebody gets to say, well, you know, we've been at this a while, I guess we can coast. And that doesn't happen. Sorry, you're gonna be working on this. I've met people that have been married 50 or 60 years and they're still negotiating things, because marriage is lived in seasons. You know, right now, I think probably what you guys are saying is, we're college kids, we have no money. So talking about money seems weird. And I remember that when Drew and I, we've been married 20 years now, when people would say, do you want to talk about, you know, talk to a financial advisor? We're like, we literally have no money. We can't talk about doing anything with money that we don't have. Well, I think that Bible verse is perfect, because it's also, you know, like what you do with the you know, least of these, with the small things, means then you're ready to be given the greater things. And that has been true in our marriage with finances and stuff. We've seen the ugly parts. We've seen having no money. We've seen, you know, we have enough to make it and we're going to be okay and flourish. And what we've had to learn is be content in all those circumstances. So I feel like as an organization, that's what we're trying to help people do, is at every stage, from teenagers, we teach, this is one of my favorite things, pick a partner, how to avoid falling for a jerk or jerkette. It's one of my favorite things in the world. And talks about how we don't get stuck in those bad relationships. So I talk to people we go around to the different local high schools. I've been on Spring Arbor's campus to teach this with sports teams and different groups. Love to come back anytime. It's a conversation we need to keep having. But then these conversations are going through every season. You know, newlyweds are different from young parents, are different from empty nesters, are different from people who are retired. So finances, negotiating your relationship is always something you need to figure out. And so the big three, when you talk about divorce, you know, we were talking about what the three big reasons are, finances and kids and sex. Those are three things. And think about how they're all kind of interrelated, those different things. And I agree with you guys when you hear you saying, and I'm glad you're grinding this into them, communication matters in anything that you do. Your personal life, your professional life, everything. Communication on all of those things, with raising children, with sex, You know, that becomes a tricky thing. If you're not communicating about that, that will be your downfall. Finances, if you're not able to communicate about that, that will be your downfall. That's why they're the top reasons, because they're things that happen to a lot of different people. You're not alone if that becomes a stumbling block. So that's really why we exist, is to help with those things.
A follow-up question is what the organization has been around for 10 years, and how do you know that you are doing the right thing? Is there any indicator that the
sure.
Your organization has been successful?
Yeah, we can't take all the credit or all the blame, but the divorce rate has fallen in Jackson County. We're now serving Hillsdale and Lenawee counties, so we're kind of doing something regionally. And we're the conversation, I guess, about marriage has been elevated. So that promote part, we did a community survey where people were asked, where would you send people, you know, like a friend or family member, if they had trouble with their marriage? They used to say just, I guess, a church or a counselor, and we were the main, you know, name that was up there. So name recognition, you know, in business, that's huge. That is huge if you can get people to recognize spontaneous name recognition. I had my board of directors actually do that. I made them go to Jackson Crossing and just walk through and ask people if they had heard of Marriage Matters Jackson. It was amazing to hear the answers and what people thought it was, or, you know, most everybody had heard of it. So we were like, that's exciting, that's wonderful. We know it's working because we hear the stories too. You know, I love having the research, we want to have that backed up, but I hear the stories. I hear the stories of the people that were filing for divorce the next day. They were going to go to legal aid, which is in the same building as us. And they walked by and they said, Marriage Matters Jackson, what's that? And they walked in, physically walked into our office, because it's one office before you get to legal aid. And they said, I guess it's worth trying. And so when you hear the story about that family that was redeemed, you know, that's amazing to me. That's amazing. Did you want me to tell about what we do, like actual stuff?
Yeah,
is that something?
Infomercial.
Well, I mean, just some of the things, because I want you guys to know there are resources. You're not just, you know, you don't have to just dangle up there. You know, one of the things we do is we talk about, my husband's a banker, so I did this for his one of his seminars there, the Love Bank. And you put this stuff in business terms. You can make anything relational go into business terms, just so you know. We have a thing called Employee Matters that we do, where we go in and people don't want to talk about their marriage. Okay, then we'll talk about your relationships at work. So we're sneaky about this relationship stuff. But in your Love Bank, everything is either a deposit or a withdrawal. You know, every interaction you guys have here, you know, you smiled at me, so you put a deposit in here. You gave me a snotty look, so you took a withdrawal. Just kidding, she did. She didn't even know I was pointing at her. I was kidding. She did. But all those types of things. But here's the one, and I'm going to give you guys one to pass around in the department. Then I'm also going to maybe give one away. Money Habitudes. Has anybody heard of this? It's a card game. Super easy. So when you're in the Ring by Spring conversation in the lounge, hanging out, play a card game and talk about finances. It says the fun and easy way to talk about money. And it seems like an oxymoron, like, yeah, right. You know, you talk about money, you're going to fight. No, this actually is. And you play this card game and you talk about what represents you. These are things that motivate you. And we're all like this. So the nice thing is, it doesn't matter if you eat ramen every night and you have no money and you're begging your parents to send you a 10 spot. It doesn't matter. If you have habits and attitudes about money. And I'd be happy sometime to come and do this with the students if they want to do this together and kind of break this apart. But it's called Money Habitudes, and it's just this thing that looks at status, planning, carefree, giving, spontaneous, or security. And a lot of times you don't even know. Like, you have no idea from your background that you're like, oh, I never realized security was such a big deal to me. And that kind of stuff. One of the couples in our office that worked for me just did this the other day. And she came into the office, she's like, that was awesome. She's like, we didn't realize that for a couple of years now we've been talking about totally different things because we're motivated by money in different ways. So I love this, and I want you guys to have a copy of that to be able to share and pass around. And, you know, have one person do it in the couple, and then have the other person do it and compare your answers. And it puts it in a fun way. I think anything that you can mix a little fun into helps take the bite out of an awkward conversation. Because, you know, I think, you know, when Randy was saying, you know, ask about the finances, it's an unromantic thing to say, can I see your spreadsheet of debt? But if you can pull out a card game, be like, let's talk about this. It helps ease that conversation.
Thank you, Shelby. We are running out of time, but we're not done yet. I want to shift gears to Hannah, and as one of the youngest member of the panel, and also the someone in a relationship. Well, what have you heard tonight that resonate well, and what are some of the things that would be rather difficult to take in? Because, well, I'm thinking about the romance part of a relationship, not the financial side of it. And finally, what are some of the takeaways? So after that, we're going to open it up to everyone for Q&A. You can ask questions of particular panelists or just throw out a random question. Before we do that, I also want to ask for the, Michelle to pass around the survey questions and the survey. And we got a simple survey that we'll encourage you to fill out and give back to the next members need to learn. We only got 100 copies, so that if you're not serious about filling out a survey, you can pass it on to someone. Anna?
Okay, I know I touched on this earlier, but I am curious, at what point in a relationship do you have that talk? Is it 6 months? Is it a year? Is it before you get engaged? Because that can be a tricky subject. Some people don't like talking about money, or some people like talking about it too much. And what do you even say? Because again, me personally, the only financial encounters I have is my tuition. So how do you say, hey, in the future you might make X amount of money, how much of that money do you want to put towards this or that? It just all seems very in the future and very questionable when you're in college. So I guess it's hard for me to know what conversations to even have about that.
Well, I tell you, I don't have any trouble talking with my wife and I first. We've been married 30 years, by the way. And, well, actually 30 years in August. And when we first met, we didn't have any trouble talking about money, because the first thing my wife said was, hey, let's talk about growth mutual funds. And I'm like, I'm married that one. But anyway, seriously, she wanted to kind of, she wasn't really that big on talking about money, but she knew that I was, so she hit my spot. And we started talking about money right away because of that, and I think she made the effort to come to where I was. And then in turn, I kind of did the same with her, and I tried to go where she was. And I think that makes a good marriage when people can do that. But we did start talking about money because I was, you know, obviously, being a finance professor, I really wanted to talk about debt. I wanted to talk about savings and all those issues. And I think you just have to bring it up. I just don't think there's any easy way to do it. You just have to talk about it. You have to force yourself to talk about it.
What about the opposite? What the, if, say, the guy doesn't seem to be interested in finance, but you as a female, you are very interested. Might be not interested in the sense of being interested, but you think it's very important, and how do you bring it up?
I think you have such a great point there, but you do see it. If they got some money from grandma for their birthday, what do they go do? Do they go spend it all really quickly? Do they say, let's go to Taco Bell and get the big box? Or are they like, you know what, I'm gonna give Jesus 10%, I'm gonna get, you know, you can see spending habits very, easily if you're paying attention. And I think that's what I want to encourage you guys to do, is pay attention, because you will know that. If they get money, I mean, I watch it with my little kids. You give them $5, which one of them goes and spends all of it? The other one, I guarantee she's got that $5 hidden in her room somewhere. And then the other one can't find it because he dropped it. You know, it's like, okay, I'm a little concerned about the rest of your life, you know? So those things you can tell with it's the small decisions that they make that will impact that. And I would say, bring up the thing about a spreadsheet. If he doesn't like it, say, how do you feel about budgeting? And if they're like, ugh, you know that's not somebody that enjoys it.
And you just say, well, I'm going to take charge.
Yeah.
Or, well, let's talk about it. Well, let's open it up for the Q&A, and we have some students in the back who can take the microphones around, so that we have a couple of three microphones.
Partner, that question about finance. Because I didn't really hear anything. I heard, this is what I get, but I want to know a date or after a certain time.
Okay, now remember you're in the incubator, so it might seem fast, but if you feel like you're talking about the intimate details, here's a way to bring it up. One of my things that you need to know, if somebody has talked about their family background, talking about your family and how they spent money is a nice way to sort of put it off on them. It's not them, but like, you know, okay, what was payday like for your family? And they were like, oh, payday was like, oh, the money's already been spent, or payday was the time we went out to eat on Fridays, something like that. You start talking about that, and you can talk about that a couple of dates in, you know, a really long, in-depth conversation. But when you start getting into that personal side, I feel like then you've opened it up to being able to do that. Now, I wouldn't say, what's your net worth? You know, what's your debt load? I wouldn't do that until you've known each other a little longer, but I really would encourage you, a nice way to make this easy is to act like one of your professors made you do this and be like, I know it's weird, but I got this card name. Blame it on somebody else and bring it up. But if you're interested in knowing what makes them tick, I think that, you know, kind of coming up with an excuse is a good reason to do it.
I love that. I also like the concept of just stating what you want for your personal finances.
Sure.
I think there's just great, you're giving your partner a gift and just being transparent and authentic in what your goals are with your finances. And I think by being vulnerable that way, you'll elicit some type of response.
That's a good point. Do you think as college students, we might not be able to afford going out to dinner as college students, so do you think that our personalities towards money will change when we're out of college, or is that what you were saying, whereas they already have these tendencies?
You already have.
Yeah, I would agree that you already have them, and how you focus on money will be how money manifests as an issue or a non-issue in your future.
Agreed. It's that thing of the first time you get a real job, and what you do with that, do you go out and spend all of it? I think those show some habits and attitudes. Does the person say, we're not doing anything fun, I have to put it away in case something bad happens? You really have these sort of tendencies. Now, everybody is gonna have a little bit of a celebration when you get that real job and it's a real paycheck, but it's how, just watching how they spent that. And I would say debt is a huge question that we've all talked about. I mean, I've got books that I'm gonna give away tonight about how to debt-proof your marriage, but like debt and Ramsey, I'm sure you've talked about Ramsey and all this kind of stuff. There are tools out there. You guys have tons of tools that you can access.
Yeah, I don't think people change. I really think that the way you are now, you're gonna be like that probably for the rest of your life unless you force that change. My wife did change with her death only because we worked together. And if I died, I don't know what would happen. But I can tell you this, that she's learned a lot over the years just watching and observing, and I think that she's probably changed a little, but probably not.
My husband has made a big change, but that was maturity. Okay. But he still has some of those basic things where he's a planner now, but that just what hadn't come up yet because we weren't mature enough yet. But he's got that planner, but he's, you know, like spontaneous too. So I think identifying what motivates you with stuff is huge because it is kind of hardwired.
I gotta tell you guys, if you live anywhere near Jackson, we're very lucky to have an organization like Marriage Matters Jackson, and that to me is the most phenomenal resource you guys have. Is unbiased insight and perspective into marriage. So utilize the resources we have. Bigger town communities than us don't have anything like this. It's really cool.
Any further questions before we close out? Melody, you got a question? No.
I'm just passing.
Yeah, passing on the microphone. Well, let me just ask you a show of hand. Not how many people have the ring, no. But if we do bring, say, Marriage Matters Jackson back to campus and have a free seminar on that kind of topics, would you sign up for free? We'll bring the seminar to you. We'll find ways to do it because it's such an important topic. We don't want to downplay that because, it's your responsibility, it's not our responsibility. To the faculty at Spring Arbor, everything matters. We don't want you to go out with a lot of debts. We don't want you to go out marrying the wrong person. We want you to be a critical participant in the contemporary world, and it doesn't mean that it's in every single area.
whether it's your family, your marriage, your work, your career, your church life, everything. We should be vibrant Christians who are globally minded. If you have not heard of this before, you'll begin to hear about it in the next few months. From top to bottom, from Dr. Brent Ellis to provost to the faculty, the staff, everybody will be talking about it because, well, this is what we are all about. So, would you help me thank everyone on the panel?